due to inadequate infantry protection and poor deployment. The Russians were able to knock the tanks out by aiming at the tracks. The Germans quickly learned their lesson, and future use of the Tiger I was carefully managed. The first large employment of the tank was at Kursk, when approximately 100 were used. Almost half of these were issued to the elite formations of the Waffen-SS and the Gross Deutschland Division. The Tiger I quickly earned a fearsome reputation against all of its foes. The tank only saw action for 2 years, but its reputation still stands today. The Tiger may have proved itself to be a good design, but the first tank destroyer, which was based on the Tiger, was a misguided failure. This heavy tank destroyer first saw life as designer Friedrich Porsche's version of the Tiger. Porsche was so confident that his design would be chosen that he proceeded with the manufacture of the vehicle despite the fact that a design by the rival Henschel company was also being considered. When Hitler chose Henschel's design in preference to Porsche's, 90 Porsche chassis had already been built, along with 50 turrets. Fortunately for Porsche, Hitler had also ordered the design of an assault gun that could mount the longer, high-velocity 88mm gun. The Tiger was found to be incapable of doing this, so the Porsche chassis was utilized as the basis of this new vehicle. The Elephant was born.
There was a force of 90 elephants involved in the Battle of Kursk, which was almost the whole elephants in existence. After all, they were only a construction by Professor Dr. Porsche, which in the end wasn't used. But since they were half finished, it was decided to put heavy anti-tank guns on top of them, close them in, so protection for the crew, and send them as they were, hardly tried, old story, back into the Battle of Kursk. They were 72 tons in weight, and they had two Maybach engines. They had no means of defending themselves against infantry attacks. And the Russians soon got used to that. You see, they let the tanks go through, came out of their foxholes, and just jumped under the tanks and knocked them out. In the first place, of course, the design was very weak in the running gear, and quite a few, just like with the Panther, quite a few broke down during the march itself because the running gear gave way.
These flaws helped to ensure that this new weapon was a failure at Kursk.
This is one of the successful attempts to deal with the T-34 menace. This is a Sturmgeschütz, which has had its main armament upgraded from a short 75mm gun to this long anti-tank weapon that we see here. Now, this was more than adequate to deal with the T-34 on fairly equal terms. And one of the chief advantages of the Sturmgeschütz is that by dispensing with the turret, they were much more easy to manufacture. You could make a lot more of these, probably three of these for every two tanks. And that was important because on the Russian front, quantity counted. There were something like 10,000 of these vehicles that were manufactured by the German forces in World War II, and it really did go a long way towards redressing the balance between the T-34 and the early German machines. There were a number of disadvantages, however, to employing a vehicle like this, particularly when it came to aiming the gun. There was very little play, and really you had to swing the whole vehicle to aim the main armament. But with the exception of the big battle at Kursk, really from 1942 onwards, the Germans are fighting a defensive war, and in that respect, these vehicles were excellent. They were fairly low, they could be easily camouflaged, and they packed a lot of punch with the 75mm gun, and you could get them onto the battlefield and make them available, and that's what Germany needed more than anything else.
Although the orders for the preparation of this attack were issued in April, The actual attack did not take place until 3 months later, in July. Delays had been ordered for a number of reasons. Hitler wanted no room for failure, so the plans were revised again and again to ensure no detail had been left out. In addition, the Führer had an almost childlike faith in the power of new weapons. He believed that the new generation of Panzers would win the war, and he wanted the new Panthers and Elephants to be used in the battle. Despite the fact that the field trials of these new Panzers were not complete, they were committed to the battle anyway. This decision would prove costly during the ensuing clashes. These delays caused further unforeseen problems. The Russians had been made aware of the German plans through the help of the Lucy spy ring that had been passing decoded ultra messages from Bletchley Park in England. They could also observe the massive German preparations for the battle, and they began to make plans to meet the threat.
It has always been said, and it is beyond doubt, even the Russians admit this today, that the Russians knew the day of the attack, they knew where the Germans were going to attack, and they knew in which strength they are going to attack. Although the greatest secrecy was exercised on the German side, the Russians were informed. Well, it seems to be assumed that a certain spy ring in Switzerland, a fellow by the name of Rössler, was in charge of that, a Swiss citizen, who had his agents even as close as Hitler's headquarters, who informed him of everything else. This fellow Rössler was working for the Russians, and since he was recruited by the Russians to work for them in Lucerne, in Switzerland, the whole spy ring and his proper code name was Luzi. But there is still a great doubt whether he was alone or even entirely responsible for the betrayal of all these data to the Russians. It is assumed that the Russians had yet another spy in Hitler's headquarters who went under the deck name of Werther. He hasn't been discovered to this day. Nobody knows, at least openly, who he was. And although the Germans knew quite well there was a spy within the headquarters, they never found out who it was.
Initially, Stalin had ordered an offensive to be launched. His generals, however, had persuaded him to adopt a defensive stance instead. The idea was to draw the German forces into a well-prepared trap and destroy them. When they were on the point of destruction, a heavy armored counterattack would be launched to finish them off. The Russians knew that the Germans would be concentrating large amounts of armor in the area, so particular attention was paid to anti-tank defenses. Anti-tank guns and anti-tank mines were laid out in pre-prepared areas that would blunt the German armor trying to punch through. The Russian defenses overall consisted of extensive lines of trenches, minefields, and pre-prepared killing grounds. These were arranged one behind the other and presented a formidable obstacle.
You've got on the central front, which was crucial of course, something like 5,000 kilometers of trenches. 400,000 mines were laid. These were obviously designed to break up tank movements. The general Soviet system was this. They had really three lines of defenses. There was the first line, of course, which was really to break up the German attack. The second line, which hopefully would in fact enable them to bring their anti-tank defenses to bear. And the last line, of course, was really this was where the battle or the engagements would be conducted, and would break up, defuse, and generally deflect the German attack as such. And this went all the way down from corps level, indeed from army down to corps, down to division, down to regiment, to battalion. Each had its own defensive sectors. For example, a corps defensive sector would run for about 20 kilometers. Behind this, deeply echeloned, were strong points, cross-connected, cross-communicated, with covering mines, obstacles, anti-tank guns, and of course the other most important element in the Russian defensive system was the artillery. So it really was a colossal undertaking.
Over 20,000 artillery pieces were moved into this area by the Soviets, together with over 3,000 tanks, 2,000 planes, and over 1 million men. The Russians had General Vatutin's Voronezh Front and General Rokossovsky's Central Front in the salient. In reserve would be General Konev's steppe front. The brilliant tactician Marshal Zhukov was in overall command. One mistake that